apostles' teaching and the fellowship to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Ladies and gentlemen, these are the means of grace.
Yeah, the Lord's means of grace are the things he takes to squeeze and make us into Jesus' shape. Yeah. The first thing mentioned, the teaching of apostles, all of which centered around the preaching of the gospel of Jesus' achievements through bleeding completeness. When believing, we can receive this free gift. Yeah. Through preaching and teaching, the meaning it deepens when reading. We breathe in the scripts with meekness. Church history is super vital to remind you that every true revival came through disciples who knew the Bible. But this gets missed today. The first question to settle any discussion is, what do the scriptures say? Not my feelings, intelligence, or wisdom. That's just a Christianized version of relativism. In the sea of uncertainty, his word would be the boy. Let's receive it with joy as it fills the deepest void.
Please destroy that poison fever that says we don't need fellowship, koinonia. See, many times believers' joy is meager, cause we're not under Christ's appointed teachers. Don't avoid your leaders, pastors, and elders, cause I testify they actually help us.
Right.
Like in a season of almost falling away, brothers call me each day to give me the gospel and pray. Christ builds up his people through his people. Stay close to the sheepfold, cause you deceitful. And let the topics not just be irrelevant. Nah, I'm talking gospel-centered fellowship. As his cherished servants, prepare our churches to share their struggles and bear our burdens.
Yeah.
But not just focus on gloomy hearts or weakness, but remind each other who we are in Jesus.
These are the Savior's means of grace.
Away from the bright lights and concerts, humble saints are quietly doing God's word.
Yeah.
Faithfully they labor in obscurity because they understand the power of praying corporately. It's all because of Jesus' accomplishments that we can be confident when pleading the promises. Answer prayers motivate us to grow in faith, so we raise to behold his face at the throne of grace.
Yeah.
The prayer meeting is the place where it's grace there. If you stay, you'll hear more crying out than a daycare. God welcomes our petitions.
Yeah.
He welcomes our confession.
Uh-huh.
He welcomes our thanksgiving, welcomes our intercession. Compelled because of Jesus. And even when we don't know how to pray, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. So let us gather to pray this week, the more the better. Weep in the door with pleasure as we seek the Lord together.
You're the Son of God and his love. Gave us the bread and drink to symbolize his body and blood. But at communion, Jesus is present by his spirit. Reminds me I'm accepted by his death and by his merit. Behold the new covenant Passover meal, showing that the blood of the Lamb has actually sealed every single covenant benefit to the one that's regenerate who comes humbly penitent.
We repent.
Christ is present to nourish our faith. This meal surely conveys assurance and grace to encourage his saints and gird us with strength. So Christ death's the center of our worship and praise.
Glory.
But before you come to his supper, run to your brother.
Be reconciled.
Cause it shows we're one with each other. So feast on Jesus who was torn and broke. Cause through this means of grace, he restores our hope.
These are the Savior's means of grace.
Many roads or paths for God's people to grow. God has used one, his ordinary means or method of grace, using the past to grow his people, used now through the church to grow his people. The ordinary means of grace, they focus us on Jesus Christ, and they're ordinary in that everyone can make use of them, and yet God will do extraordinary things through them in the lives of his people. Make use of God's ordinary means of grace, the apostles' teaching, the breaking of bread, the fellowship, the prayers, for your growth, by the grace of God, and for the blessing of his church. Amen.